our first speaker, I'm sure you all know him, Jim Graue. He's an attorney. He's a retired fireman. He's a member of the American Airmail Society. He's a recipient of the 2012 Love Award for Research. And he's going to talk about German influence in transatlantic air services.
Until I finish, see if I deserve any applause. I tend to walk around when I do these.
Let's see if they can hear you.
Can you hear you?
Yeah, turn it up.
And I do not script.
He's got to turn it on. He's got to turn it on to talk.
Can you turn the mic on?
No.
It's on.
There I heard it.
Turn it to talk.
It's there. It's on. I can tell you. Most people can hear me anyway. I got real confused about how I was going to go about doing this. You're going to get a different view than what I originally
expected.
Why did I get confused? I started preparing my paper. They sent me information, it would only be 10 pages.
Can you move it up a little
closer? That was why I had 35 pages.
Try moving it up a little bit closer. I don't think they're hearing in the back.
Yeah.
Yeah, you hear it better already.
My original idea was I'm going to talk about Lufthansa. Have someone else talk about Zeppelin. So all the Zeppelin people said, no, thanks. Well, I integrated them in because they did have an effect and I like to integrate and show how it worked. So we'll get off and running here and see what we call. Why would I say the war is the father of all things? This guy apparently was pretty charged. A little earlier than my time, not much earlier. After World War I, aviation made a quantum leap into the war. Germany lost. The provisions of the Versailles Treaty said, can't have any airplanes, can't have any Zeppelins, can't this, can't that, and can't one of that. So what they focused on in Germany was civil aviation, not military aviation, civil aviation. Made a huge difference. It took a lead to wounds attached for a long time. Only America, which had the resources to deal with both military and civil priorities, could keep up with them. Otherwise, they left them all in the dust. And you'll see why. The Graue Zeppelin, which appeared in 1928, was basically the resurrection of the dream that started in the early 1900s, and made 590 flights. We'll see how it fit into the game a little later. But that's a successful operation, 590 flights. And, German North Atlantic Catapult Airmail basically was a spin-off of a French idea that didn't work. The French didn't do it correctly. First of all, the French started off with an existing ship, the Wheel de France. They stuck a catapult on the back. They found an existing plane and stuck another catapult. And then they charged an absolutely outrageous sum, as anyone who collects those knows. They lost money head and tail. They had big trouble and abandoned the operation after a year or two. Germans looked at it and said, I think that might be an okay deal. No planes can cross the Atlantic yet. The plane goes halfway across and launches the airplane. We're going to be able to cut a significant amount of time in mail transit. One of the things they did was they used new aircraft all the time. Look at the difference between where they started and what in the lower right. You can see they're making significant progress in aircraft. custom designed and built for this purpose only. So they've tuned in and specialized on doing it right. It paid off. They scheduled 216 flights and completed 196. It's a pretty impressive record. I don't have to read it for you to look at it. But they did something to enhance the service. First of all, if you want to cut your flying time, don't fly as far as Cologne or Brainerd. Fly to someplace on the coast. They flew to Southampton, England. If that was a way they could lengthen the flight over the ocean, then connected with a regular flight in England, carry the mail over to Germany. Meanwhile, the float plane, by the way, retained the mail to Holland and Bremerhaven in that area. They just chuck it out the window on the way by. The dust didn't want them landing there. So they just chucked it out the window. It's a very fascinating story. But here's an example of a cover that is pictures the advantage of the system. On Copenhagen, Denmark in 1935, this letter was mailed after the Bremen had left port. After it left port. The Bremen had three stops. Bremen, Southampton, took some passengers and so on. They went down to Cherbourg and did the same thing. It's marked right here, the supplementary flight marker, because they said, I can't shorten this flight, but I can pick up in 1 minute before the ship actually leaves Europe. So they had a system set up where they made a supplementary mail flight or a feeder flight from Cologne. Cherbourg matched the ship just a bit before it left on this transatlantic journey. That's what this is. So this went from Copenhagen, Vaughan, Cherbourg, the catapulted, dressed to Chicago. It arrived in the suburb of Chicago station before the ship hit New York. So, I mean, it was a system that did save them a considerable amount of time. Nice example of it was supposed to happen. The ship would have gone from its home port. This one on their end, north where it's going, Siam, via Amsterdam. This is one that got chucked out the window. If they hadn't run this maneuver, it would have delayed that a week. The KLM flight to the Far East took a week. They left at 6:30 on Monday morning. And that was a Sunday flight. So there are some things that have really saved a bunch of time. Meanwhile, the French said, okay, we're going to set up an air, sea, air system. We're going to take our airmail France down to Dakar, Senegal, and then it was crossed with the ship, pick it up in Brazil. They got off and running on that, and they did it right. The Germans looked back and said, God, we can do that. Well, the Germans did it wrong. The French system was built around Aerophilately exclusively. They did the flights on both ends, and they did the ship in the middle. Germans tried to coordinate three different operations. Didn't work. They had Condor going down to Los Montes, Lufthansa going down to Los Montes. They're picking up Hamburg to America line, Cap Arcona and Cap Colonial liners, which are running on a schedule north and south in the Atlantic on a ship line schedule, not an airline schedule. And then they hooked up the Condor in Brazil. That didn't work. Because most of the time the plane wasn't there when the ship got there. The plane wasn't there, we're moving on. thing 14 times, and guess how many of them they finished? Two. That was a discontinued operation. That one didn't work. So, it was interesting. It did the transfer at sea. That's the cap arc coming off of Fernando. Another thing that didn't work great. I'm thinking the conditions of the sea at the time, if the fees aren't good, you can't land there and transfer the land. So that did not work. There's a lot of mail around left of the attempt. The attempt to do it, not very many of them. And furthermore, the second one was completed. After it was transferred to Condor, Fernando, plane crash, trying to take off. Was it re-completed? Yeah, but not very well. This is where the Germans made their mark. Wrapped up. This is the thing that really gave the French fit. When the graph doubled ran, it was much faster than the French surface. The airs to the airs started to pop by the French, not compete with the graph doubled. So when they started looking around these flights to South America in 1931, they did three more of these flights. You can see. The speed they're making, the distances they're making, the distance to first accepted, this third flight, now they're starting to accept commercial mail, multi-weight mail, 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 printed matter, business papers, sample, big sending, all that stuff. Well, they're set up for some schedule in 1932. There it is. Well, in 1932 and 33, they did 9 flights each year. In 1932, everybody was on board. 1933, pretty tricky. Not here, Brazil and Paraguay in 1933. What happened was, Aero Postal, the French service, when they went to South America, they based themselves in Argentina. Argentina developed a loyal. Understandable because they were getting a link across the United States. Wait! Every 10 days. This is a seasonal service. 9 flights a year? No, that's not that much. So Argentina said, look, in fairness to other carriers, which by that time in 1933 was having serious difficulties. They said, we're not going to use the German service until it becomes weekly on a reliable basis. So they were out of there. So this is what happens. You end up with a situation where you've got a serious drought in the average mail carriage out of South America because of the participation. Well, they said, must land flights are working really well. We can compare it to South of them, that's really a catapult out in the middle of the ocean. Well, that was the idea they had, showing big things that right here. Well, it's a good thing they ran those trials, but that didn't work. In order to maintain the schedule, they couldn't move the ship around that much. Furthermore, they had nothing but troubles with weather in and do the leg. There was one that had to sit in Brazil 2 full days for the weather to straighten itself out and didn't get there. So it had eruptions down. What they needed to get was catapult required for takeoff. We're in the tropics in the Gambia where it's trying to take off. No lift. High humidity, flat water, high temperature, no lift. So in order to take off, they have to get a speedboat out in front of them going like this, create some artificial waves, water to like glass otherwise, so that thing to break loose and fly. They said, this isn't going to work, we need a catapult short for takeoff. We need a second ship to do that, not take off from both sides. And they found out that the bigger plane they were using was far superior to the smaller. If that is the West Fall, which is a converted freighter, they used it with this catapult to see the rail and the plane system. They're using a flying boat. One little float plane is a flying boat. They worked up a bunch of mail on the first series of trial and got in trouble with the rank post for that. Because that was not authorized. They got in serious trouble with the rank post. So no mail exists within other trial flights, only the first trial flight. But they actually sent some all the way through the mails from Brazil, all the way through the mail line in Germany on the regular postal route. It was unauthorized. They were not authorized to have this cancer. They created that. Rex posted the light. They cut it off right away. So that's why they didn't work. But they didn't get going. Interesting enough, unlike today, where you have to have drive flights to go on and on. They would schedule full changes in their service before they'd even finish their trial. Pretty amazing. That's why they were able to go into business so fast. Those are the first flights in 1934. And that is the lightweight flying boat. Two huge things happened. First of all, we created Deutsche Zeppelin radar operators to hit one with the transport business Zeppelin airship. Lufthansa had a financial stake in DZR, a big financial stake, including people on their board, but the Reich's Arab industry. A coordinated controller of now all air transport in Germany. That was a very big thing. It changed a lot in the way they operated. Next big thing was the Germans and the French quibbling over the mail order. The Germans pressured the French severely. The French consistently had flown out of France on Sunday. So the Germans kept nudging their closing time closer and closer to the departure time, closer and closer to the French. They charged a little bit less than the French did. The Airmail surcharge. And they had a system that worked a little better. But suddenly they were getting all the mail. The French were hurt. French leverage was, we're not going to let it go Zeppelin fire or France. Politics. Here's the difference on the bottom. It's the difference between the graph Zeppelin flight time and loop time. Flight time by this time. Significant difference. Huge. 52 hours versus basically 2.5 plus. Lots of different minutes. So German in Airmail letter. So now it no longer matters what you said on your covers. You say, French Airmail, German Airmail, the pressure was both of them. You want to spin the game. Next service week. Germany backup is departing on Thursday morning. The French alone on Sunday. It was a big deal. And very collectible area, very confused. So I'm just labeling the whole. Now we coordinate. What we're trying to do is save time. We're trying to save time and money. And that's the way they did it. '36, you see what happens when they change that connection point. They made it further in down into Africa. Here's the time they're shooting for. Here's the connection time. Here's the Hindenburg flight time, the Zeppelin flight time. Here's the next flight time. The combined servers that we connect to Seville, Lisbon, Palmas, and Battenfield. Very interesting to collect. Meanwhile, the Hindenburg running in North America. And you can see his cast of the carrier moving down the mail. We had 10 North American flights and 7,000 American flights in 1936. Good year for the Hindenburg. Said, we've got planes that can do this better. Here's the first one. This is going to 18, flying mode. Basically, an offshoot of the ball, the way of the previous model. The card. This is all the survey flights in 1936. The ALO, those days over in New York, 200 miles over here, that's just that. This is the only existing, piece that's carried. So there is no other piece that's carried. I only had to bid on that three of earth auction over a period of 25 years. I hate being there. Trial flights with this plane. Now check that plane. Largest float plane ever built. Or diesel engine. Check the lines that baby was able to make. Very impressive. They obviously said, we got that. How about it, you asked? What's the truck service? And Ann said, wait a minute. They weren't about Juan Turkey with a world vision agent. He wanted Pan-American to have the entire world. So America persuaded the American position to give, we'll trade you landing rights. Knowing full well that Germany is an inland nation with no shoreline on the Atlantic. No landing rights anybody wants. So that's shelled that operation. Well, they made some more attempts. They still improved. This plane was also built. And that's a Jazz and Flying Boat compared to the early. This plane was also built for the South Atlantic Service. And these catapult ships, go by, they're all built for the South Atlantic Service, the North Atlantic Service. And it's just, they all that North Atlantic stuff they built for the big float planes and this flying boat, they transferred all of this out. 1939, these planes require cabs. They can take off from the water. So you've got to be careful because if you change before the plane can hit it and then service 1939, stop using the cab. There's a glimpse of a transatlantic future. 1938, New York to Berlin and back, non-stop, with that plane. Huge difference. And they carry a pocket full of these little walls. Most of them were signed, but not that many signed by the whole crew on the plane. But that forecast the end of the flying world. Well, there's your triumphs. Grab Zeppelin, the Caterpillar Airmail, the Falcon Heavy Airmail, the cooperation with France, or the triumphs. The tragedies are systems that didn't work in the Falcon Heavy. The loss of the Hindenburg, obviously. The denial of landing rights, which delayed by 2 years North Atlantic Air Service. And the war, which cost them all of the progress.
Any questions for Jim?
Let's have one question. So then we have to change the computer to the Apple because he has an Apple. There you go, Jim.
Hi there. Great call. Quick question. In preparing the mail, how did that compare to the letter that gone to New York and the AM system? What was the differential in time among the letter in Brazil, let's say, or some other destination?
Well, that was an option for a sender. You didn't want to pay the bill to send a letter on the top of that service. Send it to New York and have Dan M fly past the South America. It was less money. It was also the only option after August 39. But we have to collect that, figure out the schedule. We can't keep up, but it would have been reasonably difficult. The best thing about it was cheap. If you weren't in a hurry, it was just cheap. Pan-Am did not recognize special rate, concession rates for AOMA. They charged first-class rates, so they were careful.